But in any case, it's nice that because this I kept this presentation non-technical, so it should be sort of easy to follow, and I'll try to make up for time by going a bit faster. So the basic research is, yes, unsupervised anomaly detection using score matching. My outline, I will briefly talk about some existing work, and I'll spend a bit of time motivating on why we're using scores. And then I'll move on to my main technique, some extensions that I've thought of it, and the current progress, which is basically building a medical anomaly detector for brain MRI scans. Next slide, please. Yeah, so moving on to just the first existing techniques. But briefly, just talking about what do we mean by anomalies? It's basically unexpected data points that can show up in a variety of situations. So the financial industries, you know, you can just think of it as fraud, credit card fraudulent transactions. In the manufacturing industries, it can show up as some defects that show up in your whatever you're trying to build. The picture over here is from a popular data set called the MVTech data set that has these pictures of what the normal object should look like, and then some of the cases where you have captured a defect. And then, of course, in the medical area, anomalies basically exhibit themselves as some pathology. So it could be tumors, lesions, and all sorts of things in all sorts of body parts. Mainly for my research, we've been focusing on brain MRIs, but the methods that are built is very generic. It can be used on pretty much any image. And of course, anomalies can also be just things that go wrong, say in image acquisition. So not a pathology, but you know, something went wrong in the MRIs. So if we click next, the main idea is just that anomalies are undesirable and undefined. You know, they're undefined by definition, right? They are unexpected things. Next slide, please. And I won't go into too much details about what the existing work there is into the specific models that people use. But if you take a look at the literature, there's basically a couple of main classes of models that people have employed for this anomaly detection, unsupervised anomaly detection task. So one class of model, been it as probabilistic, where you are essentially learning the likelihood of the data. And the assumption is that if you know the likelihood, it's a very straightforward metric to say whether something is an outlier or not, where a low likelihood should just mean an outlier. So conceptually, it sort of makes sense. And you know, class of model, well, there are a bunch of generative models that can also be likelihood models. But one example would be normalizing flow models that give you a precise likelihood. You can also use other techniques like VAEs that give you some lower bound, but normalizing flow models, a few years ago, stuff like pixel CNN or GLOW models were sort of, you know, in vogue, so you can use them to get likelihoods. The other side of the of this image is about reconstruction. So basically, think of autoencoders. The main idea is just that you train some form of autoencoder, and you hope that it captures something about your inliers. And of course, the assumption here is that you're only training on your inlier data, your typical data. And at test time, what you would do to detect an anomaly is to compute the difference between the original and the reconstructed. And you know, the higher the error, the more anomalous it is, because these models should, you know, hopefully maybe we assume that they should fail reconstructing anomalies. But what are the drawbacks of these whole classes of unsupervised methods? Well, one funny thing that happens is that deep learning is so good that these autoencoders will often reconstruct the anomalies themselves. So on the right, we have an input with some lesions in it, and we have some ground truth segmentations. But we see that the autoencoder that they used was just able to reconstruct the lesions without much problems. While training, you know, everyone is hoping that you only learn something about the typical samples, but in practice, these models are just able to generalize to all sorts of images, because you can imagine that the objective function that you're training them for is not, it doesn't have anything to do with anomaly detection, it has to do with reconstruction. So in a way, of course, the better your model is, the better that it is at reconstructing. And then you're out of luck for your anomaly detection task, which was tangential. And then the other problem with probabilistic models or deep likelihood models is that it's been shown quite a bit that they fail at out of distribution detection tasks. So in this picture, we have the model that was trained on CIFAR-10, which is natural images. And then we're plotting the log likelihoods. And we see that the model is assigning a higher likelihood to a out of distribution SVHN data set. SVHN, by the way, it's not natural images, it's just digits. So there's peculiar failure cases of these deep likelihood models for this very test. To my understanding, there hasn't been a good in-depth answer to why this happens. Some people claim that it's because these likelihood models are sort of overfitting to very local features in the images. So because a image of a digit has things like circles and lines, and they also show up in natural images, they're therefore the model is sort of overfitting to these smaller features. And that's why they get the higher likelihoods. So basically, we're sort of out of luck if we want to use these existing methods.
So I have a quick question regarding the autoencoder-based reconstruction method for the anomaly detection. So will any of the regularization terms help?
They should. They'll definitely help. The question then becomes, it's more of an engineering task to figure out what kind of regularizations and stuff. But even then, you can imagine that in a way, and this is just my opinion, that you're doomed from the start because your training objective is to get better reconstructions, right? So you can, what you're doing by your regularization is more likely like an ad hoc thing that you're kind of pushing down it to be not too good, and only good at the typical samples. So it's not as clean, and I don't know if so that's why they're in cases for brain MRIs, there's no clear winner. These models, you know, trade blows with each other, and sometimes one works better, sometimes another works better.
Okay,
good question. So now let's talk about scores. So I know this lab has done stuff with diffusion model, so they have some idea of what scores are. But I'll come at it from a different perspective of why this might be helpful for the anomaly detection case. So a score is defined as the gradient of the log likelihood function. And next please. And it's basically the way I like to think about it in just, you know, simple terms. It's just if a probability density model tells you how likely you are, a score model will tell you how close you are to a likely point. So, right. So it's essentially, it's just a gradient. It's a gradient that's pointing in the direction of the highest likelihood. So the further you are from the typical region, you might say that you will have a larger score because you have a higher gradient to climb. And you might say that that is a measure of outlierness. So in this image, you can see that as you go in this contour plot, as you go down the contours, things tend to have higher gradients. And if I were to give you this image, it would be the case that you could just put a threshold on just the gradient, say the gradient norms, themselves, and you will be able to identify typical from non-typical, because the assumption here is that the typicals will be at the peak of your log likelihood, and therefore they should have low gradients near this peak, loosely speaking. But if we go to the next one, the problem is that the naive usage of scores may not work. And you can think about what happens when you don't have a nearby typical region. So imagine if I were to just look at the broader landscape around that, you can imagine how the density goes low, low, low until it sort of flattens out. Here's a very toy example of what I'm trying to get across. So we have a density on the left, and I'm plotting out the scores on top as the vector field. And you can see how there's three regions of interest. There's one at the center, which is the peak. So this is where our inliers should be. And then there's the immediate contours next to it, which is where the high gradients will be, which is good. So that means things that are sort of further away will have high gradients. But then if you go very far away, then your gradients become low again, because nearby, there's nothing around you. So if you hit next, I should have just some silly and another next. Yeah. So if you have a density of dogs, maybe cats are nearby, but rabbits are very far away. And so how can we separate out the cats and the rabbits from the dogs is the question. So if you hit next. Right. So the solution over here is to essentially consider a larger neighborhood. So if you recall, gradients provide us very local information, right? It will tell us in our vicinity, if I perturb in one direction or the other, where can I have the highest ascent? But if there was a way for me to look at a larger vicinity around me, a larger neighborhood around me, then perhaps I can get a better idea of where do I have to go. And you can see that I cleverly place the cats sort of nearby the counter, such that a little bit of an increase in my neighborhoods. Now we have higher gradients in the cat region, whereas in the typical region, the gradients will still be low. And you might ask, well, how can you just increase the neighborhood like this? Well, this is where the math comes in, where you can essentially, if you can convolve this density with a Gaussian, right? So if I pop in a Gaussian at each point, I'm looking at a larger neighborhood, and I'm smoothing out my density across. And now this is neat, because if you hit next, we're essentially capturing a difference in the gradients between the cats and the dogs, which are at the peak. But we're still missing something, which is the rabbits. So a little bit of smoothing helped us, but it wasn't enough. And you know, you can imagine what the next step would be. If we go on to the next slide, our solution plus plus is to just consider multiple neighborhoods. So the idea is that, you know, some smoothing factors will help you identify maybe nearby anomalies, and then larger smoothing factors can help you perhaps identify larger anomalies. And we can parameterize that with a scale parameter, sigma. And if you hit next, I'll just have my toy things to just show you that it is indeed the case. And this is all, these were all real plots, right? And these were all real gradients. So the more you smooth it out, if you hit next, then the more you can capture. But what's interesting is that if we still look at this typical region, which are the peaks, they will pretty much always have a low gradient compared to the outlying regions. So are there any questions over here? Because I went through a bunch of stuff. But the main idea is that a score does have some information about likelihood and how close you are to a likelihood, but a score by itself may not be enough, and therefore you need these different views of the probability density model underneath, which will help bring out where you are in regards to the data density that we as the user is concerned with. And of course, any diffusion model or score matching people will see that this is just another way to talk about multi-scale noises. And if you're familiar with noise condition score matching, you'll see that, yeah, I'm just using the different noise scales to get out these different score values. So if you hit next, I think there should be some little animations. Yeah, just right. Yeah. So now how can I actually use this? How do I bring it together in what I'm calling MSMA? If you hit next. It's basically just an acronym for multi-scale score matching analysis. So what we do is that for each scale, we can tally up the gradient norms for the different samples. So since our dogs were the mean typical density that we're concerned with, they were at the peak, low gradient norms everywhere. Cats, maybe it was low in the beginning because it was in a non-typical region, flat region, but as we increased the scales, it increased. And then the rabbits were, we could separate only at a very high scale. And then what we observed is that, if you just take these norms and you plot them out, they sort of very nicely, they can separate out your inliers from your outliers. So the inliers tend to cluster in together and in a low norm region, roughly speaking. We go next. So this is it. This is the entire pipeline, which is just that you give me this score network that can take in an input and it knows the noise scale that it's looking at. Then I just pass them through the network. And by the way, this sort of confuses people at times, but the images are unperturbed. So these are just vanilla images. I'm not adding any noise to them. All the noising and adding stuff was done during training, which I haven't really talked about right now. But from it at inference time, you pass in the image, the noise scales you want to look at, and you get out these.
Hello.
Can you guys hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you well.
Okay, give me a second. I can't hear you.
Don't know if my headphones are working.
Yeah, it goes.
Okay, thank you. I've never had so many technical issues. But okay, so as I was saying, so when you pass them through your score network, you get out your score tensors, you can take their norms, and then essentially what I do, the next step is to just train some auxiliary model. It could be, you can pick anything. It could be a clustering model on the inliers. It could be what I tend to use is a Gaussian mixture model on the inliers. And then you use that to get a added distribution metric. It's very straightforward. And just briefly, the actual learning over here is by score matching. We're estimating the score function. Next, please. Is essentially just the denoising score matching loss, which is a very nice property that you can essentially just train the model to regress against a noisy perturbed input. And you're essentially just trying to estimate the noise that was added into the input. And it has very close connections to a denoising autoencoder. hit next, please. And then this will just show you one more time that, right, so where you, the sigmas over here are present in the noise distribution, and then you can train it very easily with a just a combination of summing over all the noise levels. And in this, I'm showing you the noise condition score matching stuff that came out back in 2019, I think. But I can also use, and I am using the SDE formulation that these diffusion models use. Everything still holds. And yeah, so it is very flexible. And in our original paper, we showed that this works very well for average distribution detection. In this case, the training set was CFAR-10. And then in this particular sort of benchmark scheme, there's a bunch of other test data sets that you can use as your average distribution cases. And we basically got very good performance, perfect or even near perfect performance using MSMA. And in this case, I'm showing you that you can use different sorts of auxiliary models that are trained on the score norms. So mixture model, normalizing flow, or a KD tree is sort of like a nearest neighbor distance based model. And then in the same paper on the next slide,
So that means we can do unsupervised like differentiation between different classes of images just by the score norm, right?
Yeah. Just by these multi-scale score norm.
Multi-scale norm, okay.
Yep. Which is very neat because a lot of people already have these models that they're using for gender modeling, but you can also just use them here. And in this work, we also just had a very toy setting where we looked at brain MRIs. Essentially, we took brain scans of children around 9 to 11. And the thing to note is that at very early ages, the brains do look noticeably different from adult brains. And you know, when you're around 11, you're kind of close to an adult brain. So the task was, can we just separate out very young brains from adolescents? And this is an easy task. So, you know, a non-medical person can just do this visually. And if we hit next, not only were we able to separate it out, what I kind of like is that it also followed the logic of what you would expect, which is that the 1 to 2 year olds are further away than the 4 to 6 year olds. So that was sort of like a nice result that we got. And yeah, next, some extensions. The basic one is localization. And again, it's the straightforward thing, just turns out that it works, which is to take, instead of norming over the entire spatial image, you can take out patches and look at patch norms now. The other key thing is that the model that you feed it to should know about the positional information. At some point I was trying like mask images where that patch was highlighted. So, you know, like a one hot kind of image. But in my case now, I just use the like 3D positional embeddings, sort of that we see in, you know, either in diffusion models or transformers. So that the model knows which patch it's looking at. And turns out that works reasonably well. The likelihood model that I'm using is a normalizing flow. So essentially the flow models just see these score norm tensors for all the patches. And then you can imagine how, like I can just convolve it across the image and produce these heat maps out. Next slide, please. This is just very early tests where I took the MNIST images and a model trained on MNIST, and then I just, you know, threw in some random patches as anomalies, and the blue dots are the centers of the anomalous patches, and then you can see that the model was able to sort of highlight those regions generally. So these are some early results.
So what are the differences between the anomaly detection in the patches, that is here, the localization, versus the detection on the images?
Well, the difference is that I'm looking at patch-wise scores. So normally in the out of distribution detection, I would take the norms across the whole image. So just, you know, summarize the whole image.
Yeah.
Now I just look at one patch and take the norms across that. So I'll have, you know, however you want to discretize the image into a grid. So for each patch, you will have your however many scales you use. So if you use 10 scales, it would have 1 by 10 vector for every patch. And you just feed that into the model independently. So, and then, you know, so each block over here, and you can kind of see that, you can kind of make out the squares in these images as well, that each one was an output of the score, patch-based score model, the patch-based MSMA model. And if we go next, I think, yeah, so this is a bit more recent. This was using an updated score network, a normalizing flow model, slightly fancy. But the idea over here I'm showing you, this is just some experiment that I did with the MVTech dataset. So this is a cross section of a cable. And you can see that the abnormal cables just have, you know, just the wires coming out somewhere. And you can see that on the right are the actual outputs of the model. And you can see that it is roughly highlighting the right things. And the yellow parts are just the extreme percentiles. My favorite example in this is actually the bottom left image, where it highlighted a region that was indeed scuffed, that wasn't yep. marked in the original data set, which was neat. So we go next. So an extension to categorical data, I think I can go through this sort of fast. Basically, the idea is that it's hard to add, you can't add continuous noise to discrete data. And the way we train these models is always using some form of denoising. So the solution here that I found, and now this is sort of maybe old work, that people have found other fancier solutions to this. But the one that I found is that if you treat this one hot vector as a probability distribution, you can just perturb it so that it's sort of smooth or less smooth. So if you hit next, perturb the probabilities, yep. And then one more time, you can imagine that, yeah, so if it was days of the week, I can put in probability masses into the other areas. So if you take this view, next please.
So you mentioned there are fancier ways to do that. What are those?
Yeah, so people, so in diffusion models, people have figured out ways to do, so if you remember, this is related to diffusion models. So if you remember, there's the score matching perspective, mm-hmm. and then there's the Markovian perspective, right?
Yep.
So people have figured stuff out in the Markov perspective, where you can think of transition probabilities, and you can use, I think it's called multinomial diffusion. ArcMax flows and multinomial diffusion is the title of the paper.
Oh.
So they did that. And there's also ways which are sort of related to score matching as well. This was sort of recent work out of Google, I believe. That you can also think about, I think it's called ratio, likelihood ratios between the probability of seeing one event, and you can sort of diffuse the probabilities.
Wait a minute.
You are muted.
Yep, somebody, let me see, how do I unmute you? So
is
I cannot. Yeah, it's good now.
Okay. Yeah, sorry about that. But yeah, point being that there are new ways, and then very, very recently, I think you could also, maybe there's work that came out of Alex Graves talking about Bayesian flow networks. I think there's probably insights over there as well that you could use. But if we go to this next slide, I can just show you my little trick, which is to notice that in the denoising score matching formulation, there are no restrictions on the noise distribution, which is important to know because everyone uses Gaussian noise, but you can use any noise as long as it's differentiable and you can just, you know, compute a nice closed form gradient. So what we ended up using is a Gumbel softmax, and turns out there's a tau parameter in the Gumbel softmax that can help you smooth out probability distributions. And I was using that as a notion of noise. So if you go next. Yep, we add noise by smoothing out probabilities. You can compute a nice closed form gradient. So it's actually not that terrible to code. It does take a while for it to train and converge. But if we go to the next slide. Yep, next. We can see that it works well for detecting anomalies. And I think, yeah, I have the paper up on archive. You can see some of the results.
Tabular data. What's the application of this one?
The application?
Yep.
So it would be outlier detection, anomaly detection on tabular data. So that would be, you know, Excel-like data. And we had another test, acute test of looking at uncertainties in segmentations.
Mm-hmm.
So I got segmentations out of a trained model, just, you know, took something out of PyTorch, trained models. And then we were able to rank the segmentations according to their uncertainty. And we saw that, okay, this model was able to say whether or not it was a good segmentation or not. Our scores tended to correlate well with the mean surface distance or some other segmentation distances that we used. Okay, current progress. Here is basically the whole research was to get down to this point, which is to train a 3D anomaly detector in brains. So essentially my training data is, you know, how I mentioned the 9 to 11 year olds. Well, yeah, they're coming out of this ABCD data set. So I'm combining some sample from ABCD and another HCP development age group. So I have around 1600 samples total and roughly around 1200 for training. And we do some pre-filtering and of course a bunch of normalization stuff. And in my test set, I'm going, you know, from easy things to more difficult things. The easiest were the synthetic tumors, which is just threw in a Gaussian blob into the middle of the brain. And then the synthetic lesions we generated through 3D slicer, it's a program that you can use. It has a MS lesion, MS lesion generator extension. So we use that. Then we also have a few cases from our in-house data set with Down syndrome. So the idea is, can we detect Down syndrome as an outlier class? And of course, I don't have results for it yet, but the holy grail for us is to test our model on detecting ASD, so autism. And then also, can we use the localization model to detect where the brain differences lie? So here next, I have some results, just a few. So here's some ROC curves for detecting lesions at a sample level. And you can see the generated tumors are just very easy for the model, but the lesions can be a bit tricky. But in any case, it works reasonably well given that it's unsupervised and 3D. And it's usually pretty hard to get these models to work well in 3D. And next please. Yeah. So this was about the Down syndrome. Basically, since the sample size was so small, I had to just, you know, do a bunch of repeated tests just to get some nice averages out. So these are not the best results. So Oh, hold on. I should be explaining that I'm showing you the area under the ROC curve, area under the precision recall curve, and the other two metrics are your false positive rates at a very specific true positive rate. So basically, if I get 95% of the true positives, and in this case, it would be the Down syndrome cases. So if I get 95% of true Down syndrome cases, I'll have 22% of them, of the entire selected cohort, would be false positives. They don't look the best, but they are good numbers for detecting Down syndrome. It's usually not that easy for these models to do it automatically. And I've been trying to, you know, improve on these through other things. Go next, please. More results. These are very fresh about submitting the anomalies. So now, previously we were looking at, so this is the lesions, by the way. So previously we were looking at what it was at a sample level. Now I'm looking at getting the heat maps out, doing some thresholding and post-processing to get segmentation masks, predictions. Again, all unsupervised. And then here's what we're doing against an autoencoder baseline. And you can see that our distances and our true positive rates are a bit better. Right. And then the last stage is conclusion. We can quickly go through. So yeah, scores inform us how far we are from a likely region. Okay. And we need multiple neighborhoods to maximally capture outliers because you don't know how far away an outlier is. MSMA works pretty well. And patch-based MSMA can localize anomalies, so it's a very neat extension. And then you can find some of this work in my GitHub repo.
Yeah. All right. Very impressive.
Thank you.
So any questions from the audience? Okay. If that's so, then we can wrap up today's seminar a little bit earlier, because we have another meeting on 12 exactly. So see you then and have a wonderful week. Bye.
Thank you guys. Thank you for having me.